Hello, hello, and welcome to another episode of Lumpia with a Vengeance. Here I am with Darian Basco. So hello, good evening to the people that are here in the US. Good morning if you're joining us from the Philippines. Yay. So we're just talking about the cast and crew and talent behind what is now the award-winning feature film, Lumpia with a Vengeance.
Yeah, give us some horns.
Okay. Right. My name is Tiffany Lopez, and I am one of the associate producers on this film. And I will let Darian introduce himself and what he's doing on the film.
Yep. I am Darian Basco, and I play Bayani in the film. Yeah, and I can't wait for you guys to see it. Very proud of it. And like you said, we already won an award, so we're already winning. So I bet it's amazing being here with you, because I know you were a second AD on Lumpia as well, right?
Yes.
So it's amazing just to be here with you and to talk about the film and talk about your life and your career and mine. So I'm excited to be here.
Okay, wait, I have to address an elephant in the room. Did I mispronounce it? Did I mispronounce the name?
You did?
Dude, is that why
you did? Were you practicing and then you were just practicing? That's okay. Don't worry about it. So say my name again.
Okay, Dar.
There you go. It's all right, because it happens all the time. Like, I tell people, I can meet people, like, right face to face. Hi, my name is Darian. Nice to meet you. Okay, Darian, come here, follow me. And it's just weird. I don't know. That's why what my name, when my coffee name, or anytime I write, it's Diego. I mean, that when I get coffee or do anything, that's my name, Diego.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because they're like Darian. I get tired of Darian, but it's not too bad. I'm used to it.
Okay.
But
and yes, I'm totally used to everyone calling you Dar too. So I'm like, wait, I need to ask him, like, what? Okay. Here we go.
You're totally good.
Okay, I have to address it. You know, we love you. Okay. So, who do you play in the film?
Yeah, Bayani. Yeah, we did that. And I'm trying to solve the crime in the flick. And there's history and there's stuff from the first film as well. But yeah. Oh, play the clip.
Okay, yeah, play the clip. Okay.
It's okay.
Okay, we're back. Let her
go. She has nothing to do with this.
Help me! I'm vegan! I can feel the Lumpia grease seeping into my pores!
Yeah, we're crossing over.
Okay.
So yeah, that was a good clip that we just saw of you. Okay, I need to tell you, as the associate producer on this film, my first time I met you, it's really like prototypical of your character on this role or in this film. Okay, so let's set the scene, okay?
Okay, go ahead.
That's how I met you.
Go ahead.
Right? You know, so we're in Daly City, fog town, super foggy day. It was kind of nighttime. So very like Gotham, can I say this? Like very Gotham City life, right? Like we all know about this, about San Francisco and Daly City. It's reminiscent of Gotham City. Okay, so you pull up in like a Uber or something, like a really nice Uber. You pull up and then you get out and you're like in full wardrobe. So you pull up in front of the high school, super foggy. You get out, you have like this long kind of trench coat thing. And then I took you downstairs through the high school, downstairs to the office where we have the set and where you had your scene. So it was just like perfect. The detective, like when you came, I felt like, okay, because I mean, I'm working in the film, right? So I'm like in the moment, like this is really going on. We need this detective. And you came out of the car, like all detective-like and went down to the basement and then you did your thing. It's like, you didn't need anything. It's like you were the person, so. And you know, knowing the family, knowing you guys, like you guys are super honorable and like, you know, you're a super cool guy. And so I'm like, I believed it.
So I appreciate it. That's crazy. That's the first time we met. That's the first time we met. Amazing. Mm-hmm. At Daly City City Hall. That one?
No, Daly City, at the high school.
At the high school. Yeah, yeah.
Shout out to Jefferson High School. Awesome. But yeah. Good awesome. Times.
And you're also were associate producer on our film, Fabulous. So then we met again.
Yes, that one I was second AD, but yes.
Second AD.
Totally.
Second AD.
We met again, no problem. We've worked together, so yeah,
we
it's
did.
All good.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, a couple roles.
On our crazy picture, yeah. Amazing.
Yeah, so Fabulous Amazing. Filipino Brothers. It premieres, woo-woo, South by Southwest this week.
It does.
Tomorrow?
It does.
Tomorrow.
Kind of nervous and excited, mm-hmm. but you know, it's always crazy. Like you were on it with us. Mm-hmm. Just like Lumpia, it was just like a labor of love as well, and a low budget movie that, you know, you're struggling to get your days and you're doing, so you never know how it's gonna turn out. So it was crazy, like, and then that it's been well received already and it's at South By is exciting. And we're super excited, but at the same time, we're very, very nervous as well to see how people respond.
So I'm curious, like, what are the vibes right now with the family? Like, all, you know, like, this is a big, you know, week for you guys.
Yeah, we're excited. Like, we're super excited. We've done some press and done some things. And so far, like, the response has been good. Like, the people who've seen it. So... We're told, I mean, it's always that weird, and this is like, it's a very personal movie, like, you know the film as well, like, you were with us when we were shooting in Pittsburgh, shout out Pittsburgh, East Bay, hometown for where you're from as well, and it's just a very personal story, so being that it's a personal story, and we're telling these, like, inside family things, and my whole family's in it, you know, my whole family's in it. My brothers who are actors, and my sister who's an actress, but also my parents and then my extended family, like, they're all in it. So it's kind of like a home movie in a way. And so we're extra nervous to show up because of that as well, but excited too, because it is a feel-good movie and we're proud, very proud of it. So the vibes are good. They all send their love to my brothers. They send their love to you.
Yeah, well. Yeah, for sure. Send it back.
Right on.
So
right
I
on.
Have to ask this question, like, are you, I'm sure you're not tired of working with the family, but is that something you like prefer, or is it something like, okay, like, I, like, do you ever have that contention with that?
I love working with my family. I mean, it's really unique, the relationship we have when I think about it, but I absolutely love it. I mean, we grew up together, like, and studied together. We've been working together ever since we were in Pittsburgh and the Bay. We started as breakdancers out there in the 80s. So we started breakdancing. Did you?
Yes.
So we started as dancers, and we all around Telegraph Avenue, you know, Pier 39, like, just everywhere. And then we went to contests all of us. Then we got into San Francisco Ballet Company, like on a Billy Elliot type thing. So we auditioned as young street dancers. They were looking for people who were like, who had potential, I guess. And then we had like indefinite scholarships to the ballet company. So we would go, my mom would commute us from Pittsburgh into San Francisco every day. And then we were studying ballet. It was like a total culture shock. It was our first sort of introduction to like fine art in a way. Like we would be
culture shock. Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I have to say Pittsburgh. Kids from Pittsburgh going to San Francisco Ballet.
Crazy.
And like
every day, like in the skyscrapers, like, and the we were dancing and the view of the bay and grand piano playing live with us. We were like, this is amazing. And so that was our first sort of culture shock and being like, oh, and then we did the Nutcracker. Like we started working professionally with them.
So cool.
And then we got in, and then I'm kind of telling you our story of our career. What happened was from that point, we, had a discussion with my mom and my dad, and they asked us if we wanted to move to LA, like if we wanted to try Hollywood. It was like, it was really, it was like, and at this time I was 11, Dion was like 8, Dante was 10, Derek was 13. And so we jumped in the van. I don't know how we convinced them or they convinced us, whatever way it went. We jumped in the van with my mother, the four boys, and $100 to move to LA. And my dad was working for AT&T in the Bay, and he gave we've been here ever since. It's just crazy, you know, crazy. But that's kind of how, that's the beginnings of our career. And all, by the way, like, you come from a big sibling family as well, right? Like,
I hear do, you're, yes.
And also you're a twin. And you started in dance as well, right? Like,
yeah,
you started
totally.
In dance as well. So tell me about your story.
For sure. So the reason why I asked is my family, we're artists as well. Like, it's either artists or military, like very Mexican, right?
I got very military, artists, military roots too. It's the same. I'm telling you, our Mexican
California.
And Filipino cultures is very similar.
We're fighters. So go ahead. Lovers artists, here we go. But yeah, so I asked because actually two of my brothers are in Lumpia. So one of them's so they're like henchmen. One of them's like a henchman biker, and then he plays like then another person. He's like three different people. It was great. And so like I get them involved like in my stuff, which is cool. So I guess like for starters, I was like a little child model, and that's how I got like into this world of art and theater. And then so I did dance, and dance was like my first love. And then in community college, I have a brother who's like a big thespian, Shakespearean reader, writer.
Oh, really?
Like totally Shakespearean lover, like the one that's person amazing. I know. Yeah. But yeah, so he wrote a play. he wrote a play in our community college, West Valley, shout out Saratoga, California, that I directed in our community college. So he wrote it he starred in it. He acted. And then, so I directed, it was beautiful. Oh, I loved it. It's probably crazy. It's on YouTube somewhere, but anyway, yeah. But it was kind of like a post-apocalyptic story, and the characters, like the tribes represented different like family members. So he was like the middle child. And then so like, he has a lot of interesting perspective about being my older brother, being like the younger one of the siblings that were all like, you know, like born like 80s, 70s, he's a millennial. So interesting perspectives. Anyway, so working with my family is seriously like epitomizes like doing what you love with people you love, you know, right. Like I love working with them since we were kids. I'm sure like you can relate. We were just sit in the living room and just watch TV and just like talk about our stories and create stories and wanting to be a part of it. And, you know, just like having fun with each other, bouncing off ideas. And it's
absolutely.
So beautiful.
Like, don't you meet some people sometimes and they don't get along with their siblings. It's crazy to me. Like they're like, how do you spend so much time with your brothers? And you're like, they're my people. I mean, I don't understand how people don't, but I guess I get it. But I mean, it's just not my experience for sure, but you know.
Same. I remember in high school, like I have a twin brother, and so people would like ask him and ask me, like, "Oh, you don't hate her? Like, you don't hate your brother?" And I'm like, "Dude, like, we're hanging out afterwards. What are you talking about? Like, no. Like, to this day, like, they're my best friends. I prefer to hang out with them, and you know, our lives like go like this, but we're still like, no, like that's my own boy. Like, what?
Me too. Yeah.
That's like my. Thing.
Yeah, and it's crazy how I mean. It kind of shapes you, right? Like in a way, like in it shapes who you are, like your relationship with your family. Like I know, I mean, I'm a little bit of introvert by nature, but going, it was like such a blessing to have Dante and Dion. Like we're in high school with me because they're so extrovert. Even now, like they're so like they're outgoing. And so it gives me like. I had the opportunity to be with a bunch of people, or I could just be with myself, which is cool with me too. You know what I mean? And right. I always have built-in best friends, which is cool. You know?
I like that. You're like, I'm cool with myself. Like,
yeah.
But yeah. Okay. We have to give a shout out to like the people that are watching on the Kumu app. Thank you for joining. We love you guys. Thank you so much for supporting.
Thank you for being here.
But yeah. So I really wanted to get into this. But yeah, so the Cesar Chavez Day is coming up. I believe it's like
it
March
is.
30th. Yes.
Yeah,
and
his
you
birthday
were
is
in
really close
that
to
movie.
Yeah. I was in that movie. That was a great and a bunch of my family's in that movie too. So like I bring even when I get a job, I bring my family with me. So
I know, and I know you have so many great stories, but I want to start. Okay, so we talked about Lumpia, yay! We talked about Fabulous Filipino Brothers, shout out, and okay, Cesar Chavez.
Sure.
Let's start with like step one, like audition.
Step one.
How that happened.
Yeah, auditions. I mean, they come up and they come up, you know, whatever. And a lot of times you're auditioning for things you don't really care about. but this came up and was like, well, I really want this. And then, of course, okay, when you're auditioning, why? Because I've known, because the history of what it is, I mean, the importance of, first of all, who Cesar Chavez was, but then also knowing, because when we're coming up early, like I knew my family, I have family that worked in, I knew the Filipinos had a vital role in the whole story of the labor movement in the fields, and it hadn't been told yet. And there was these great heroes, Larry Itliong among them, who needed to be told. And that was the part that I actually got to audition for and eventually play. And we had a connection to Cesar's little, his cousin, Dolores Huerta, or his nephew, Cesar, Dolores Huerta's nephew, grew up with us a little bit in the poetry scene here in LA. And he would always tell us, we're brothers and sisters, like you, us Filipinos, he was really passionate about too. He always come at us, strong on me, Dante and Dion, like, we're brothers, like, you have to know that we're brothers and sisters. And I was like, I get it, yeah, we totally are. But then when I started to do the research and for the role, I mean, I totally get where he was coming from. So like I said, when we started audition, of course I'm auditioning against my brothers, because I mean, if there's a Filipino role, we all audition, so we all audition. I happened to be lucky enough to get the role. And then when I was talking to, and it's directed by Diego Luna, who's an amazing actor.
Yeah.
And so when we started talking about it, and we were and sitting with Mike Pena and everybody, and they were going to shoot the movie in Mexico, they were like, well, we're going to shoot in Mexico, but we don't. And it wasn't the biggest budget film either, although it had great people in it. They're like, we need Filipinos, but we can't really get Filipinos there. Do you think your family can go? I was like, I'll ask my family. And so then my whole family, like, my brothers came, a bunch of my brothers came, my uncles and aunts, who are all, a lot of them in Filipino, fabulous Filipino, my mom and dad are in it. So we're all the Filipinos, like in the camps and in the fields. It's a lot of my family. And then they got a lot of Mexicans who look kind of Filipino too, which some,
right.
Some
I know do. We can play back and forth, like, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So it was, I mean, like that film, especially like that film was a lot of time for a lot of people was the first time that they knew that Filipinos were actually involved in the movements. Like Cesar Chavez's name is big, but Larry Itliong and the Filipinos, as it shows in that film, and it doesn't necessarily highlight enough for me and for a lot of people, a lot for of sure. Filipinos, obviously. About the role that they played, because they actually are the ones who struck first, who went on strike first and kind of forced the Mexicans. And then once we joined forces, we were much more powerful to do what we were able to do. You know what I mean?
Definitely. I mean, I have to second that. You know, I'm associated with a lot of like Mexican activists, and mm-hmm. a lot of them have said, talking to them after watching that film and just the narrative of Cesar Chavez, like, no, like the Filipinos started a lot with like the sittings of like locking them, like that scene where I saw your brothers and you guys were all in there of the Filipinos like locking themselves. Like, right. Can you talk about that a little bit of like that strategy?
Yeah. Literally that's what they did. They were before they had to lock themselves in their camps and said they weren't going to come out, weren't going to work, weren't going to do anything. And they were basically a hunger strike too, until the wages were higher. And the reason why they were able to do it and stay organized is because they were older a little bit at that time too. They had been striking up and down from Oregon, like the migrant workers, and the Filipinos had been, they've been here a longer time. And so they were organized, a little bit more organized. So they were able to do that. I mean, and the crazy thing too is like when we were doing the press and we went up and down the coast and promote the movie, it was Mexicans were super supportive as well too. The ones that were in the movement and the elders that knew, they would always come up to me and be like, you're right, like Larry Itliong's story needs to be told, because he kind of made a lot of it happen. He was hardcore. He was like, and the Filipinos, they need their due. Like they're super supportive. I mean, it's crazy. It was crazy. It was a great experience to do that.
So are you gonna play him then? That would be amazing.
I don't know. That's like a dream project. Like that's like a dream. Like I've done a lot of research and I talked to other Filipino writers and directors and stuff. I mean, it's one of the dream projects that I wanna do, if we ever get a chance to do it. Or, I mean, I kind of want to, the other thing that I have a concept too, because there's a great documentary by, it's called Manongs. That was a great research for me. And she was a great source for me. She's a Filipino girl who grew up in Delano with the Manongs. And it's called Manongs. If you could watch it, it went through PBS and she did it. What's her name? Maybe I'll get her name, and I'll give it to you. But it shows their lives in there. And like, you see all these young Filipinos, like by day they're in the fields. And then at night it's the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s. And they get all dressed up in their suits and they go to the dances and they're dancing and they're with their Mexican brothers and they're dancing with all the white, because Filipinos couldn't bring the women either. They didn't have any women. And that's another, there's a lot of interesting stories that go along need to be told for sure. I mean, anyway, that's a dream project. Yeah. That would be sort of like one of the dream projects to do. How about you? What's a dream project for you? Like, what would you want to do?
Well, I mean, like
anything.
Yeah, I guess similarly, just like to tell the stories of my people in any type of shape, way, or form. And like, I'm not so like on, oh, I need to tell one narrative, how it's supposed to be told. Like, we're artists. And so I would love to write something and just to have like, you know, a collaborative effort and it show like different cultures and how we connect and you know, but my dream, I, honestly, you want to know, like my passion dream project is in my head. Mm-hmm. I would love to do just like a cool, like Latino musical, but also like with different people, have Filipinos, have like white people, have like, you know, like African-Americans, like all the above, you know, but like very like Latino centric, like musical. Like I love musicals and I don't think like,
oh, you do.
Like, you know, there's some cool ones.
Are you excited for In the Heights like coming out? What? Are you excited for In the Heights coming out? Did you see the trailer for In the Heights? You're excited?
Yeah. It's cool. But honestly, but I love that. Great stuff. But like for like a Latino, we've watched like Zoot Suit, you know, like Zoot Suit, all of those movies and just like that style, especially like the Chicano style. And like what you were talking about, like with the 1930s and 40s and like getting together and like partying, like that whole Zoot Suit stuff is so dope. Like,
I think so too. Like that's what, like if I would, that's another dream project is to do like a show, sort of like a TV show, but sort of like Boardwalk Empire style, but in the field, like on the West Coast, in the fields with Mexicans and Filipinos, like young Mexicans and Filipinos, like running things. And like, you see like their relationship with each other and then their relationship with the growers, like, you know, with the growers and like, that whole era, that's a Zoot Suit era too. And like, we can go into like the riot of the Zoot Suits because there's a lot of the Mexicans and their Filipinos.
Oh, for sure. All that activism
All that activism.
LA riots, right?
There's a lot of things there. I mean, it's rich. It's rich.
Exactly.
I mean, you know?
So, but yeah, like it's interesting how it comes together, right? Like our communities and stuff. And I guess like, that's how I came upon like the Filipino-Mexican connection is how I came upon all y'all. Like through Lawrence. Yeah. And so, So, you know, like I danced on like some of the stuff he was producing. But at the time, I was at this community college and he was working with Cray TV in San Jose. It's like this, this community organization. And so they needed to put this video together and it's all these community organizations that like have, great professional equipment. They're right under like ABC Studios in San Jose, but they bring kids from the community and they give them lessons on like Adobe software or like, you know, like all, and then they have like camera gear, like all top line stuff. Anyway, so Lawrence was putting like a promotional video for that. And so he needed an actress and I was like, you know, doing stuff at the time. And so, I brought me on. And ever since then, like I told him about wanting to produce, I guess, long story, like I wanted to be like, in musical theater and stuff. But when I would audition, like it was very just like, you know, like I didn't like what I was auditioning for. I was like 19 years old. I have 7 brothers. My dad's like a pastor and all this stuff to me was crazy. Like MTV, can I say this? Like MTV, like all these weird auditions, but what they wanted female my age group to do. And that like pissed me off. I kept seeing that, like what I qualified for. More skin, do this and that, or typical roles, you know? And so I'm like, hey, like, let me produce. So So Lawrence brought me on to do Lumpia, and then he brought me on to do Fabulous Filipino Brothers. And, you know, that started this. So, I mean, like, for me as a Mexican, like, Cesar Chavez, like, you guys brought us in, like, you know, doing this work. And so, I'm super appreciative to, like, my Filipino family and community. Honestly, I didn't grow up with Filipinos, but I'm, like, growing up as an adult with Filipinos. And I love it. And I'm just super appreciative to be, like, included in these stories and to be, like, a part of it. And I'm learning so much. And hi, Lawrence. He says hello.
Hey, what up, Lawrence?
But yeah, shout out.
You're doing better.
Right. I know, Lawrence. Yeah, shout out to you.
Yes. And so let me ask you, what is May It Burn? Was that something that you did, that you worked, that you created?
That's the play that my brother wrote. It's called May It
Burn.
That,
that's the one you're talking about. Oh, right on.
Yeah, it's actually the catchphrase. We didn't know what to title it. The catchphrase comes from like, a dialogue, and it's something, you know this, like if you do really good dialogue in life, like it'll stick with you, right?
Yeah.
And like in moments you're like, oh, you'll recite it, like this is the truth, if you're, you know. So my brother plays the protagonist, and he's this guy, and he says, may it all burn before I come, or may it all burn before I become what I became, what I came to destroy. Let me say that again. May it all burn before I become what I came to destroy.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like the antagonist is his brother, actually, and it's like a brother of mine who was like his bully growing up. Shout out to Jacob, we love you. But for real, and so the antagonist, and he's the military brother, like complete different directions, and he's just kind of like crazy. And but yeah, so that would be a great like film. I think I'd love to do one day. It's super relevant, Lawrence. Mm-hmm. We have some great like scripts and ideas also, and like, but it's based telling our stories, really. Yeah. It's not really self-glorifying a lot. It's just like, let's tell.
It's important. It's important. You know? Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's important because, and you're also American Indian, like talk about your roots, those roots.
Yeah. So my family has been in California for over 150 years on both my mother's and father's side. Yeah, and so I identify as Yaqui Indian. Shout out to my Yaquis. I'm just kidding. But yeah, no, Yaqui, Yaqui Indian, and yes. And it's just a beautiful, you know, I've come in my adult life to expose myself to that culture. I wasn't raised with it as much. I have family who are registered in the tribe, but going to powwows or ceremony was not something I've done as a childhood. In my childhood. So doing it as an adult is just so fulfilling. And so I go to Sonoma State University, and I'm like minoring in Native American studies. And it's crazy. Like it's super crazy. And so for Native American History Month, last year, I did like a rendition of the Yaqui, traditional Yaqui deer dance. It's a ceremonial hunting dance. And so like, it's interesting because like, of course, in these dances, like no female really do, they don't dance. Like men a lot, they did the hunting, they did a lot of the dancing. And so I believe it's like one of the first times, at least on film, that I've seen a female do this dance. And so, you know, I have 7 brothers, like I love hunting, I respect it, we do it. And so it was just very emotional to get inside. I play the deer, like, and I prance, and I play the deer as like someone would come up on me and kill me. And my background's in dance. And so it's my own interpretive style. It's on YouTube. I think it's on my Instagram bio or something. But anyway, yeah, it was great.
That's amazing. Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah. Good stuff. Good that's stuff. Amazing. And that's another community that's popping right now. They're all over like TikTok, and like they do cool, like informative, like dances, you know, and then they have like little facts and stuff, like what they're doing now to like spread like the love, you know. It's pretty dope.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, that representation is it's important. I mean, you know, these stories that we're talking about, to me it's like that's kind of like what we're why we're in the business, why we do what we do, is because like they need to be told, and they need to be heard, and they need to be celebrated, you know, just because, and done and that's why we try to do them as best we can, because it's just important for us growing up. Like we didn't see it so much, you know what I mean? It's getting better and better now, but if we can continue to tell these stories, it helps. It makes everything richer, even for people who don't know that they need it. You know what I mean? It's great.
Yeah. That's interesting. So I have a question. So if you'd go back to like your, like, I'm gonna, like 10 years ago, you know, what would you tell yourself as an artist, you know, about like the future when it comes to representation?
Well, I would say like, from, like, I would say that, like, I would, I mean, I would tell myself, I would say that you need to like, be like where you're at, like now, like where you, like what you came to in your journey pretty quickly, like knowing that if you want to do certain roles or want to have a voice the way you want to, you're going to have to produce and write and direct much sooner. You know, and I would have got into that game much sooner because I was lucky enough to do The Debut, which is iconic and great representation, and Cesar Chavez. Some of the very, those are like the very few roles that I've been able to do that I'm actually could be proud of in that realm of things, because like you said, I mean, if you just wait for what people are going to write or what the business is doing, it's not going to be as rewarding as what you want to do. You know what I mean? So I guess that would be kind of the talk I would have with myself. Like, bro, you got to sit down and write. You got to produce. You got to figure out what. Yeah. And it's great. Like, again, coming back to like, I'm lucky because I'm in this family that a bunch of brothers and sisters, and then the community that we've kind of created around us with Patricio and Francis De La Torre and Andrea, all these filmmakers that are Filipino or an ethnic or geared, or their mind is open to these stories. Like, it's like, that's what you really need to do, is like create with this community, because you're going to need support, and right. And then really sit down and be specific and figure out what projects you want to do, and then go after it and try to get it done, you know?
Right. I mean, yeah, honestly, one of my favorite quotes when I was like in high school doing theater was, life isn't about finding yourself, it's about creating yourself. And so when I went to these auditions and trying to find a role, I was like, this is bullshit. I'm not doing this. Sorry if I can. Yeah, like, I'm not doing this. Like, and so, yeah, creating. So I wanted to get into creating. So segue into The Debut. Tomorrow is the 20th anniversary. What?
Wow. I mean, it's crazy. Crazy. That I didn't say crazy. That. I mean, I'm old as hell. Pat, we're old.
I mean, you got that good Indigenous blood, okay? Like, let's give it up. And so you're only as young as you want to be. Just kidding. So, okay. So the debut, it premiered in San Francisco. And
it did.
I guess we want to talk about, it was self-distributed. So can you talk about like the self-distribution?
I can. And explain what that means. It was four-walled, self-distributed at first. And the hero of that whole thing was Patricio. I mean, he was the guy, he was MVP of the whole, of the distribution. Yeah, no, Gene for sure. Gene is why the project exists. I mean, Gene is amazing. Gene and John, I mean, amazing. Like, they're both, like, they created this beautiful thing. But then, I mean, this is my experience. That's when I met Patricio, was on the tour where we would tour it. And Pat was like MVP to me. Like, he was like, he was doing, and that, and he says it too. That was it. The whole experience was his film school. And so the thing is, the debut, to think it's 20 years is crazy. Like, I'm sure we're going to have these conversations tomorrow because we're doing the whole thing and we're celebrating it a bit tomorrow, which is crazy that tomorrow is actually a day when it first premiered, and that's the day that Fabulous Filipinos is premiering too at South by Southwest. So it's kind of like full circle. It's crazy.
Isn't that beautiful? That film, like, when life happens like that, though.
Isn't it's crazy. It's
like
crazy.
You're on the right track. Like,
it's crazy. But like, that was the first movie. Like, that film, I don't know. It's important to a lot of people for different reasons, but for our family especially, because it's important for those reasons as well, but then also because of the fact that we all had a chance to be in it and do some strong work in it, and then it was kind of like, I mean, it wasn't the beginnings of our career, but for me, it was like when I first started to know like that, like when I remember shooting it and shooting the fight scene in specific. You haven't seen it yet, but when you'll see it, like there's a pivotal scene, like there's a fight scene in it. And you know how when you're like, as an artist, you're like, you're kind of like working, you're studying, like we study, like, that's one thing I would say too, is like study, like or get good at what you're doing. Like we study. So as an artist, you study for years, and like, you're trying to find your voice through your art. You're trying to make it come through, you know, especially as an actor or musician. Sure. It could be anything, art, painting. Like you have technique, you have everything, like these things are coming, but you want to find your voice through it, like through the thing. And when I shot that, I remember shooting the scene, the fight scene, and it's a really intense scene between me and Dante. Like he's the lead, and I'm kind of like the antagonist. And we had this fight scene, and all the brothers are in it, all the boys. And I remember after doing it or being in it, and then after shooting a couple takes and thinking, it finally clicked for me that when, as an artist, we're like, I know how to do this. This is my voice coming through this. And you know what I mean? Like it was a really special
magic happened.
Special moment for me. Yeah, exactly. Like, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? Like even through dance, like, you know, like when you're dancing, there's certain, you know, the technique, you know what, like if you're doing something, but then when you're actually, your voice is coming through, like you're feeling it in a different way. Like there's something that clicks and you're like, that's what it is. That's what I'm looking for. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm.
Lumiere 21 on Kumu says hi. Hello.
Are we freezing? you're freezing up. Am I freezing or you're freezing?
I'm probably freezing. Okay. Are we back?
Okay.
Just kidding.
Okay. She's freezing on mine, but if we're good, we're good. But my bad. Right. But anyway, okay. There you are.
Yes.
Say that again. I did. I said some. No.
Let's see.
Do I see? Did you? Okay. Yeah, I see it. Okay. So Tiffany.
Just gathering some thoughts.
Right. Yeah. So being that you were on both Lumpia and Fabulous, what are the takeaways that you got from being on the set? Any highlights for you, or and what can you take away from being on the set of those two crazy movies?
Right, I know. So let me start with Fabulous Filipino Brothers first. I mean that was the like one of the first times I saw like family filmmaking. So that really hit home to me and with my family.
It must have, yeah. So, I didn't realize your family. Yeah, I didn't. It must have, yeah.
It was so beautiful to see like you guys behind the camera. And people always think, people want to like antagonize or people want contention, right? So they're like, oh, like, are they arguing? No, like you guys were like vibing in and out and you see the brother dynamic, but it was all like, you guys had the same goal and you guys respected each other. And it was like a beautiful, beautiful thing to be a part of. It's productions obviously are not done like that. There's a whole like whole strain in to it, you know, but I think being in a family atmosphere was beautiful. Was everything. Was just like, we light up. I'm Latino Mexican. We love family. So that was great. And honestly doing Lumpia too. I mean, you worked in non like Black and Indigenous people of color productions, right? Just like mainstream. Yeah. It's so different, you know? So being on it set is. with people of color on Lumpia, and it was beautiful. And being in people's homes and seeing the family aspect, I'm like, you guys are just like us, you know, just like the family connection. Like everyone, you know, everyone is a tia or auntie, you know, and like it's all good. It's all love. There was good food. And so it was beautiful. And it's kind of like what, to me, art is about. Art is about like expression and family, you know, to me, like, and so.
Yeah.
It was beautiful.
No, I'm with you on that. I'm totally with you on that. Yeah.
Yeah. So 10 more.
And then tell me about Sandstorm. Is that a film that you made? Did you produce it, direct it, write it?
Yes. No, I acted in it. I acted in it and did some little like freestyle dancing. That was actually a 24-hour film festival. So 24 hours to shoot this. Lawrence directed it. I believe it was best directed. Yeah, in San Jose. So shout out to people from San Jose. Woo woo. Yeah, so I'm from San Jose, and yeah, it was beautiful to film there.
I got family out there, of course. Yeah.
Right. Shout out. But yeah, and those stories too, like the East Side San Jose, like that whole scene. Like I'd love to talk about it and to paint that color of what that smells like, what that looks like, what that feels like. They're pretty iconic, you know, low riding on the East Side, San Jose, Sunday. So, yeah. It's a thing. And so like, it's not talked about as much and, mm-hmm. you know, it's beautiful. So like, those would be great things to share. And I look forward to
it. So do you, since you do both, do you prefer being in front of the camera or do you prefer being behind the camera? Would you say?
That's a really good question. Probably behind the camera. I mean, I love dancing and stuff. The whole point, like for me to produce was so I can like be in more control of the roles I get. And so that's something like Lawrence and I definitely talked about. And I do still like work on like my monologues and like in theater programs and stuff. But honestly, it's like therapy. Like, I don't think I could ever give acting up. Like the first time I was on stage as an actress, I was like running and like, you know, there was this white guy that was like very military and he killed my family. And so, and I have a military family. And at the time it was like during 9/11. It was after that, but we still had people in Iraq. My brothers were overseas. And so I ran and charged this guy and like got caught midair and I was just yelling at him. And it was so therapeutic. And so I don't think I could ever.
That's the great.
It's personal.
That's the amazing thing about the things that the art that we do is you do get to work out your thing. I mean, it's really, you get to work out your own stuff, like really what's happening. I mean, that's, definitely. And if it's good art, it's personal and it costs you something and it should, you know, I mean, like you're getting these things out and it's universal. I mean, the pain, joy, whatever, if you can get to it, it's universal. You know what I mean? That's kind of like the beauty of what we do. Like we're mm-hmm. able to get it out in our work. You know what I mean?
Right. So same question to you. Yeah. Now that you did like, you know, more filmmaking with your family and acting, like what do you prefer?
Well, I mean, my roots are in acting. So, I mean, I don't know if I'll, I mean, sometimes I think maybe I should not, I mean, you know, you always have these thoughts like, oh my God, but I'd really like to produce, like, I want to direct something like, I mean, and write, I'm working on these projects with my sister and working on these things. So, I mean, I like it. I kind of like behind, I mean, maybe it fits my personality better, but I'm still gonna act too, I guess, you know, if I'm lucky enough to.
Oh, for sure.
You know what I mean? It's like a real, it's like crazy. It's like, you know, I don't know.
It's like, how do you choose crazy. Between a favorite child?
In a way, I mean, I guess, but it's like to me, child, it's like, yeah. the thing that makes the acting interesting is that the roles like, and the things are, have kind of meaning. You know what I mean? Like Lumpia with a Vengeance has meaning. Like these things have meaning to me. So I guess it's kind of has to be a combination of both. I mean, with you, like you too, like, in order, like, he's got to be a combination of both. It just has to. I mean, that's like the way it is. And that's the way balance. I'd rather it be. Do you know what I mean? That's the way it should be, I guess.
Yeah. Balance. Okay.
Trying to see what kind of questions do I have to. Okay. Go ahead. Hit me.
Yeah. So Faye de los Reyes, she played your mom.
My mom. Yeah.
Yes. And so she wants to know if she has permission to slap you in the face.
Anytime. You know, I mean, she was, I love her. She's hilarious. Her spirit's so great and loving and funny. And you're so talented. I hope you're listening, Faye. I love you. And she can always, you can always slap my face like that. Like, it's crazy. Cause people come up to me. So like that, cause they love that scene and they're affected by that work we did in that scene too. And they're like rude boy. And they call me rude boy. A lot of like some of my friends, but also people that I don't even know, like they're hitting me like rude boy because it's because of your line and because of that scene, like that was amazing. Like, I love her. She's original rude she'll boy. Always be a part. Rude boy. Yeah. She'll always be a part and she can always slap me. You can good. Always slap me, Faye, when you see me, give me a kiss and slap me.
Right, few minutes. Okay, but honestly though, let's give a shout out to all like the elders on the sets of both movies, to your please, family yes. elders, to Lumpia and Pat's family and all the like they really made it. Like they were hilarious. They like set absolutely. The tone. Like And especially, I mean, your uncles and all that, and seeing them together, and then seeing you guys, like, it's just like, it was great. It was great. Shout out, guys.
Shout out.
Beautiful. Okay. So yeah, unfortunately, I guess like that's our wrap.
Our time is up. Okay.
Yes. Thank you guys for joining us tonight. Thank you, Kumu, thank for supporting you. Us. Woo-hoo.
Thank you. It was nice getting to know you too, Tiffany, more.
I know. Yes, deeper. Definitely. Like, we definitely have to connect. And I'll help you produce the movie about Larry. I'm just kidding.
We want to
also thank all the backers who funded our comic book last month. Pre-order for issue 2 will be open soon. Get ready. We will announce our film festival premiere for Lumpia with a Vengeance. Dar, let everyone know how people can watch the fabulous Filipino Brothers.
Well, you can get tickets to South By, but those are kind of expensive. So I understand if you don't, and because it's all virtual this year, and they only have one ticket, and a ticket for everything, which is cool. If you're into film and music and tech stuff, it's worth it to you, because you get to see the whole program of the whole festival, but it's expensive. So other than that, I don't know if we can officially announce, Pat, but we are going to be up in the Bay Area in CamFest. They're locking down all the details, and hopefully it looks like it's going to be a double feature of Lumpia with a Vengeance and Fab Filipino Brothers, which will be awesome because we can all get together and show love and be together and everybody could see it. But other than that, we're going to see because it's in that phase, it's doing festivals and it's looking for distribution and all that stuff. So not 100% sure when the general public is going to be able to see it, but stay tuned.
Yes. Stay tuned. Good luck on beginning of like the film festival tour.
Good luck with everything with you too.
Thank you so much.
See you soon. We'll be up there. I think it's in May is the festival. So we'll be up there. You'll be there, I'm sure.
It's gonna be a Bay Area party. So yeah, come back next Monday night with another pair from the cast and crew. And go on live for a question, a Q&A chat. Yeah, thank you everyone online.
I think my brother Derek will be on next week.
There you go. Who sends
you love to. Derek will be on next, I think so.
And a sincere thanks to everyone who joined
thank
us.
Thank you.
Dios en Chima Nabu, which is God be with your journey in Yaqui. We love you all.
Thank you. Love you. See you soon.
Shout out to
April. Love that lumpia.
Kamusta
kababayan ko. Oh, my sexy panoys and panays.
Welcome to Fogtown, where over 60% of the population is Filipino.
Can you confirm that the restaurant incident is the work of the so-called taquito man?
What?
This is the taquito everyone is talking about. It's not a taquito.
It's lumpia, the Filipino egg roll.
The motives of the lumpia man are still unknown.
Lumpia man knows we're selling out of Fogtown High.
What did I tell you about these kids?
Love that.
Lumpia!
And love that.
Lumpia! And your sniper took down the mayor as planned.
My henchmen are trained to be 100% efficient.
Is that the egg roll man?
Nah, it ain't him.
Go, 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 go! Hey, you can't eat that.
Remember me? You're my hero.
Now's not the time to change the plan.
What plan?
What the?
Please tell me you're a good guy.
It's too Filipino.
It's like soy sauce and salsa. Getting messy.
All merged together in harmony.
Screw your mama's wedding.
Fight the bully!
You're all wrong!
It's all because of this damn Lumpia man.
It took this long for me to find you. I'm not about to lose you, baby. You can be sure I love you forever.
No more! Fogtown will remember me! Taquito boy!